Shalom to Alex Friedfeld, investigative researcher at the ADL Center on Extremism.
Shalom.
So these days we're talking a lot about the coronavirus, mainly about health, also of course about economy, but you guys are telling us that there's an anti-Semitic side to this story.
Yeah, absolutely. So I started tracking kind of anti-Semitism surrounding the coronavirus back in mid-January. I noticed it popping up on more extremist platforms, things like Telegram and Gab. And that's actually not unusual in those communities, right? It's unfortunate, but these guys tend to take any major news stories and glom onto it as a means to spread their message. But what I started to get concerned, right, and what started to alarm me was when I saw anti-Semitism popping up on more mainstream social media platforms, things like Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and Reddit. And so that's when I started to kind of track it, and I started to kind of break it down to various different tropes in terms of anti-Semitism.
So what are the main claims and lies?
Sure. So there's a lot of different tropes that are being thrown around. So one of the popular ones that I've noticed is, this notion that Jews have the power essentially to control major global events, right? And so people are essentially saying, you know, they're framing the coronavirus as a bioweapon that the Jews or Israel released in order to achieve, you know, to further their objectives, achieve more power, expand their power and influence, right? So under this narrative, you see it taking a couple forms, right? So sometimes it's a bioweapon that was designed to target enemies, for example, of Israel and the United States, right? So they point at the fact that China and Iran have been hit some of the hardest as evidence, right, that this is a weapon. Sometimes it's used to target, it's part of a larger kind of Jewish conspiracy. This notion that basically Jews are trying to depopulate non-Jews in order to expand their influence, expand their power, and stall kind of this new world order where they'll be at the top. And then there's other forms of this. But, part of this is also this notion that that Jews are greedy, right? They're viewed kind of as scheming, as manipulative, and those tropes are kind of being thrown around as well. So under this story, Jews are essentially trying to profit and exploit other people for their own financial gain. So sometimes this tale is basically that, you know, they made this virus, they released it, and they're the only ones with the vaccine that they can sell. Other times it's that they're trying to profit off the stock market variability.
And I understand it's not only about theories, anti-Semitic agendas and ideas, it's also issues that are practical. What to do regarding the Jews in these days of the coronavirus?
Absolutely. It's unfortunate, but there are extremists online who are encouraging people that if you start showing symptoms of the coronavirus, you know, to go to your local synagogue, to target a Jewish community, to even travel to Jerusalem and essentially, you know, cough on things, cough on people, do whatever you can to spread the virus among the Jewish community, right? So they are explicitly viewing the coronavirus as a tool that could be used to harm Jewish people around the world.
So when you see these dialogues online, does it seem that the audience are influenced, maybe even convinced?
So it's hard to tell whether or not they're convinced. I think that there is a large push, you know, by extremists to kind of get this messaging out. And I think we're in a time where two things are happening, right? There's a lot of fear and uncertainty, and people are looking to try and understand what is happening. And so, you know, these narratives are being pushed as an explanation, right, for what's going on. And the second thing is, you know, a lot of people are shut in their own homes, right? And what do you do when you're home? You look at your phone, you're on the internet, you're constantly looking at these things. And so there's more kind of attention being drawn to these old anti-Semitic arguments. Whether or not it's having an effect is hard to measure. I do think it's important to note that you do see people out there pushing back on this narrative, right? Calling out anti-Semitism where it is, and pointing out the flaws and how dangerous these arguments are. This isn't one-sided, right? This isn't extremists just throw things out and everyone, you know, assumes it. There is a push and pull, and like I said, there has been a strong pushback in these online communities of calling out anti-Semitism wherever it is. Extremists tend to glom onto major news stories in any way that they can, right? They have these beliefs, right? And so they are looking for major news stories that they can talk about and try and get their views out there and keep pushing it, right? Because if you, for example, are looking for information on the coronavirus, you may end up by accident, right? You may not mean to, but you end up on an anti-Semitic on an article that's advancing anti-Semitic arguments, right? And some of this is subtle, right? It's not always so easy as just kill the Jews or, you know, Jews did this, right? Some of it's more subtle. Maybe it's referencing George Soros or the Rothschild family. And so, you know, as you're consuming it, maybe you then Google and you start going down this rabbit hole where you get exposed to more and more extremism, right? So a lot of what we're seeing, again, is these people pushing it and trying to take advantage of a moment in time, which is why it does tend to happen again and again.
So, Alex, what could and should be done?
Well, I think it's important, you know, a lot of this stuff is happening, like I said, on mainstream social media platforms, things like Instagram, Twitter, Reddit, and all those companies do have options to flag offensive material, right? It's obviously not a guarantee that you'll get rid of it, but a lot of these posts do violate the terms of agreement, right? And if it's egregious enough, you can get these people, you know, deplatformed, right? So that's something that anyone in their own home can do at any time. If you see something anti-Semitic, hit the flag, right, and alert these social media companies that this is happening on their platform. Part bigger than that is, you know, just calling it out wherever you see anti-Semitism. Like I said before, this stuff tends to fester in darkness, right? If nobody is out there combating it, it just spreads. And so everyone can kind of, you know, if you see someone spreading an argument, and sometimes it can happen on your own timeline, right? It's a friend or a friend of a friend or what have you. Call it out for what it is and say, hey, that's anti-Semitic, or hey, that's a hateful message. You know, people have to be aware of what they're saying, right? And a lot of the times the stuff that spreads is because things have been decontextualized, right? So to provide that context for them and explain, you know, the ADL has a lot of great resources that kind of go into the history of anti-Semitism and the various forms that it takes over time, right? So sharing these resources so that people kind of understand that what they're saying, you know, has a long history, and you know, it hurts, right? It causes harm.
So it seems that we're seeing a reminder of who we are and what we always have to deal with throughout the generations.
Yeah, no, it's unfortunate.
Alex Friedfeld, ADL, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. Stay safe.